In and of itself, it's a beautiful work of art. I'm really in love with that piece. Because I think he takes responsibility for how fucked up the position of the artist is within the global economy.
And so in 1982, Joseph Beuys initiated the planting of 7,000 oak trees all over the city area of Kassel. As a result of your work, various trees and plants have been planted on a former Unilever palm oil plantation in the middle of Congo.
That's correct.
How did that come about?
That's a long story. I knew of Beuys, of course. And I think a problem with much art that deals with the problems in this world is that it only brings capital, or trees even, to the centers of empire, to Kassel or New York or Berlin. Even the critique on the global economic system that we inhabit, the artistic critique on that, mostly brings more wealth, beauty, capital to already rich places. There are exceptions, but not so many. And I think this is a structural issue, you know, where, how does critical art operate within the global economy? Where does it accumulate wealth? Where does it accumulate even green, beautiful, inclusive ideas? So I've been thinking about this a little bit. And then I found out that Unilever is one of these companies that on the one hand raises entire rainforests and puts palm trees, establishes monoculture, 1 million palm trees to produce fat for the world.
Dating back to the
colonial period.
Right.
Yes.
And especially like in the early 20th century,
exactly.
Many areas in Congo were managed.
Yes, Congo, of course, I'm Dutch, but I have an affinity with Congo. And we all do. We all eat products from Congo continuously. The very camera has products from Congo in it. Continuously, we consume that. So anyway, 1911 was the moment in which Unilever started these huge, huge palm oil plantations in Congo. And later it has evolved into a big art sponsor, including the Unilever series, for example.
In Tate Modern. London.
With all the big artists of our time, Bruce Nauman, Louise Bourgeois, Tino Segal,
Olafur Eliasson,
have all worked around, you know, pressing issues of this time, you know, how the new economy, this and that, ecology, the big son of Olafur, etc., etc., funded indirectly by millions of square meters of rainforest being cut down, people working on it for $8 or $20 per month. That's an average salary on these plantations. So that means the kids die. And then it produces great art in Unilever, in the Unilever series in Tate Modern. I think the 7,000 Oak project, of course, it was a big thing, and it really expanded what art could do. And it also goes beyond the physical art object that Beuys was also still very much invested in. So it's extremely important. Also, on the other hand, it strikes me as monoculture. 7,000 oaks kind of reminds me of 1 billion palm trees. Whereas, of course, what has been destroyed to build 1 billion palm trees has been a multitude of species and plant species, types of human behavior, human activities.
The title 7,000 Oaks, though, is a little bit misleading.
Okay.
It reveals that it was actually different sorts of trees planted all over.
Oh, really?
Kassel, because different trees need different soil. Yeah. But still, there's the title.
The 7,000 Oaks.
I get your take on the idea of monoculture.
Yeah.
With your film Enjoy Poverty,
that you
presented in 2008, you made a kind of, you say it's like an anti-artwork. It like disassembles the whole stage.
Yes.
By filming its own means of production.
Yes.
By exposing the audience itself, like seeing their own implication in the economy that is represented. After that, you took a much more, let's say, constructive take, and resulting in actual agriculture and art production in Congo.
Yes.
Could you elaborate on that?
So it was very strange to me to find out I can make this very critical film about an anti-artwork almost that exhibits that the traction of art, the traction that art claims to have is really very limited. That work is then shown at Tate Modern, and around me I see the Unilever logos financing great artists, again, Tino Segal, Louise Bourgeois, Olafur Eliasson, Bruce Nauman, the biggest artists of this age, really, financed by the company who pays those people $10 a month, and where I have just made a film about how terrible that is, that film, so it's completely absorbed. So I made a film that once again exhibits it, but then I thought, okay, we need to move further. And then I come a little bit in Boyce's territory. He made all kinds of works of art, including advertisements for whiskey in Japan, to finance the planting of trees, 7,000 oaks. I think in and of itself, it's a beautiful work of art. I'm really in love with that piece. Because I think he takes responsibility for how fucked up the position of the artist is within the global economy. There, he's like showing, oh, this is my cup of coffee. Yes, it's anti-racist, but you know, I still have to like drink it on TV so I get 400,000 euros so I can plant my trees in Kassel. So I think it's really a revelatory piece of art.
Ideally, I think in your practice, both gestures would be combined, right?
Right.
The planting of the trees, the drinking of the whiskey,
they should
the generation
be together.
Of capital.
Artistically, of course, it's so much stronger if this is one consistent field of work and not something separate. Now, in Boyce's case, I really still like it. I do connect the two. And I think anybody who connects them sees how that the tension between the two is so productive. And we kind of build some kind of reverse extraction apparatus. I called it a reverse gentrification program first, but now it's much more than that, I guess. People make sculptures out of this depleted earth. They make self-portraits that are speaking of their past, but especially also the future. They're like deep, untold stories that often I can't understand. They have big rhetorical arguments constructed in clay. And then one of the members of the cooperative, Siddhartha Masala, who's a fantastic thinker, he scans these sculptures so that they become 3D files. And in Amsterdam, where I live, we reproduce them in palm fat, coming from plantations, of course, and cocoa, also coming from plantations. Not this plantation, cocoa comes from, I think, from Brazil. The palm fat comes from Malaysia. It's a global market. And these sculptures made out of this depleted earth are reproduced in those products coming from the plantation.
Like luxury big chocolate.
Big luxury, like big, yeah, it's like a Mars bar with a lot of ideas in it and a lot of, I don't know, content. It's beyond, as Boyce would say it, it's not really about the form, it's about all the, how it's loaded with being, with energy. Now, these have been exhibited. The New York Times said it was one of the best exhibitions of the year a few years ago when they showed in New York. And with the money, they made like, not 400,000 euros, but still a lot of money. And CATPC, so this cooperative, buys back that depleted land, hectares and hectares and hectares, a lot of land. And they plant trees, but not just palm trees or this trees or that trees, oak trees. They kind of regrow the forest that had been cut down to do palm trees, to make profit, to spend partially on art in London. That land is now through art, through the sculptures made by this cooperative, Cercle d'Art des Travailleurs de Plantation Congolaise, is now being regenerated and it becomes a forest again that people can inhabit also. A forest with medicinal plants, with herbs, with bees and insects can live there. So it becomes a forest again. So we use the art together. We use the art to regenerate the very forests that have been cut down to make profit, to fund art in London. Now in Lusanga, Central Congo, this forest emerges again, and it's through art. So many museums have been funded brick by brick by bags of cocoa from plantations. The Luckwijk Museum in Cologne, it's built by plantations. The Van Abbe Museum in Eindhoven, built by plantations. So many of our historic museums, brick, it's not just that the content of the museum may have been financed by extractive capitalism. The very museum has been funded brick by brick by profits extracted from plantations. So one of these museums, a tiny one, the White Cube, has been now repatriated to one of these plantations. The White Cube that we have built, OMA designed it, so it's like a legitimate museum. It's not in bamboo or something. Legitimate, you know, state of the art. This is like the benchmark of what a global museum should be. Well, one of them is now on one of these plantations. Lusanga, formerly Leverville. And of course, it frames what we do, and it frames the history, and it hopefully also creates another future in which museums that have historically benefited so much from plantations, that now at least one plantation can become new again, can become whole again, through the presence of one museum.